Our next star obtained her PhD degree in neurophysiology of aging.
Yes.
Completed her research fellowship program in anesthesiology at Ohio State Wexner Medical Center in 2016. She has a lot of research interest in neurodegenerative disorder and aging, and was a principal investigator in clinical research, stage 1, 2, 3, and 4. Dr. Nicoleta have extensive clinical research experience in postoperative delirium, pathophysiology, analgesia, and what's called model of multidisciplinary approach for transitional of care for geriatric surgical patient. She has published more than 80 research publications, a very big number, you know, in peer review journal, and presented her work at national and international forums and conferences. American Society of Anesthesiology, Forum of European Neuroscience Society, and the International Brain Research Organization. Again, I think you must give a big hand before Dr. Nicoleta start, because you don't found the time to give her a big hand. And she will take the lead now from Dr. Attayar, and will be the our next pilot. Let's start, Nicoleta.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if you you can share with me the screen. The screen is okay. Do you have any technology problem?
Sorry.
Okay, so I'm just going to go further. So as an introduction, it's just a pure theoretical review. So we're not going to reinvent the wheel with this presentation for sure. What I intend to do, this is not my area of high expertise, but it's an area of research. And what I would like to do is to present some basic theoretical knowledge that everybody, I assume, knows very well, and to give a hint of further exploration into this field of anesthesia for pregnancy-induced hypertension. So this is my scope for today. Now, as I said, we're going to go through a short introduction. We're going to move to anesthetic management. We're going to talk a little bit about postoperative care, of course. And basically, using the keywords from my title, I was able to come across a recent published review that I will talk about at the end. And of course, the summary of our presentation. Now, in introduction, as you know, hypertensive disorders are the most common complications of pregnancy. They occur in 6 to 8% of pregnancy. Of course, this is a percentage that might change recently. And account for approximately 15% of maternal deaths in the United States. The National Blood Pressure Education Program Working Group on High Blood Pressure in Pregnancy categorized the 4 forms of hypertension in pregnancy as gestational hypertension, chronic hypertension, with suffering post-preeclampsia, and preeclampsia and eclampsia with or without HELLP syndrome. Now, because it might take like more than 2 days to go through all these topics, for today I choose to talk about preeclampsia. Preeclampsia is a very well-known subject. It's a pregnancy-specific syndrome of unknown etiology that always occur after 20 weeks of gestation in a previously normotensive woman. It's categorized by hypertension and proteinuria. The incidence again varies between 3 to 7% in primipara women and 1 to 5% in multiparous women. Preeclampsia can be mild or severe, mild preeclampsia being categorized by a sustained systolic blood pressure like more than equal with 140 and the diastolic blood pressure more than equal with 90 and the proteinuria of 300 milligrams in 24 hours urine collection. Preeclampsia is considered severe when systolic blood pressure is 160 or higher, with a diastolic of 110 or higher, and a proteinuria of at least 5 grams in 24 hours. Preeclampsia is associated with oliguria, less than 400 milliliters of urine in 24 hours, the cerebral and the visual disturbances, pulmonary edema, thrombocytopenia, and impaired liver function. Eclampsia is defined as the occurrence of a seizure in a woman with preeclampsia that cannot be attributed to other causes. Now, the anesthetic management of preeclampsia, pre-anesthesia evaluation, and the patient preparation. For patients with severe preeclampsia, it is important to have a flexible anesthetic plan, preferably more than one option, as the situation may change suddenly without prior warning. It's a very fluent situation. Before any anesthetic intervention, it is important to ensure that hypertension is well controlled, concurrent problems such as eclampsia and pulmonary edema are treated, and physical examination should include evaluation of the upper airway to document airway classification. Of course, adjusted by laboratory investigation with complete blood count, coagulation panel, liver function test, urine analysis. Blood and blood products also should be ordered as necessary. Patients with the platelet counts of 100,000 and above may receive regional anesthesia safely. And for those with platelet counts less than 100,000, the decision to administer regional anesthesia should be based primarily on the clinical situation. The monitoring of patients with the mild preeclampsia is made with the ECG and the automatic blood pressure cuff for patients with severe preeclampsia. Iradial arterial line recommended for accurate monitoring of arterial pressure and for sampling of blood for arterial blood gases, coagulation panel, liver function test, and of course, the serum magnesium level. Analgesia for labor and vaginal delivery, epidural analgesia is indicated for pain relief for labor and delivery with the following decrease in serum of catecholamines and increase in uteroplacental and intervillous blood flow. This is highly beneficial in preeclampsia patients who already have a vasospasm of placental circulation. If rapid delivery of a fetus via C-section is considered, epidural block can be extended for an adequate anesthesia. With the correct hydration and the slow induction of block, hypertension can be minimized, of course, with the correlated with the central venous pressure, CI cardiac index, and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Now, application of combined spinal epidural anesthesia, CSE. This technique can be used safely to provide analgesia for labor and delivery in preeclampsia, and my research paper actually mentioned this method. For the intrathecal dose, an opioid alone, such as fentanyl or sufentanil, may be used, or a combination of bupivacaine, 1.25 to 2.5 milligrams with the fentanyl, 25 milligrams, or sufentanil, 10 milligrams. Epidural infusion of the same local anesthetic combination, it's used to maintain analgesia until delivery. Now, regional anesthesia is the method of choice for C-section, for cesarean delivery. Due to its proven record of maternal and fetal safety, The maternal mortality rate directly related to anesthesia is approximately 60 times greater in those receiving general anesthesia compared to those receiving regional anesthesia. The mother remains also conscious and is able to interact with her infant. There are no significant changes in PCVP, CVP, and CI from baseline due to epidural anesthesia for C-section. And the serum levels of stress-related hormones, such as catecholamine, ACTH, and cortisol, remain unchanged. Suggesting techniques for regional anesthesia for C-sections, I tried to put together two tables. I didn't have enough time. I just want to mention aspiration prophylaxis, make sure that blood and blood products are available as needed, start a second peripheral intravenous line, CVP and PCVP monitoring as indicated, hydrate with 1,000 ml of crystalloids or infuse enough fluids to increase CVP to no more than 4 milligrams mercury or PCVP of 5-8 milligrams mercury. Monitor the fetal heart rate until the beginning of surgery. Insert epidural catheter, start administering 2% lidocaine or 0.5 bupivacaine with 100 micrograms of fentanyl in incremental doses. Maintain left uterine displacement. Treat hypotension with ephedrine volume of both. And at the end of surgery, start epidural fentanyl infusion or give a dose of preservative-free epidural morphine for postoperative pain relief. Again, for general anesthesia is indicated in case of coagulopathy, fetal distress requiring emergency C-section with the no pre-existing epidural catheter, or patient's refusal of regional anesthesia. The three most important considerations, however, are airway edema and the possibility of difficult airway management, exaggerated hypertensive response to endotracheal intubation, and drug interaction between magnesium and muscle relaxants. Different sizes of endotracheal tubes, oral of nasal airway and laryngeal mask airway should be available in the operating room. Magnesium prolongs the action of muscle relaxants, and therefore the neuromuscular block should be monitored with a nerve stimulator. To blunt the hypertensive response to tracheal intubation, labetalol is effective. And the use of NTG or SNP should be guided by invasive hemodynamic monitoring. Again, this is part of a table with the recommended technique for general anesthesia. Nothing new, just kind of like a review of steps to administer aspiration prophylaxis, additional intravenous line, placing an arterial line, beginning pre-oxygenation, EKG, pulse ox, monitoring fetal rate, induction of anesthesia, and at the end of surgery, a reverse neuromuscular block, and labetalol 5-10 milligram IV before extubation. Now, for the post-operative care, the patient should be monitored in the recovery room or obstetric intensive care unit for the next 12 to 24 hours. Magnesium infusion should be continued to prevent eclampsia, and the risk of pulmonary edema should be considered with careful monitoring for evidence of pulmonary congestion. So the treatment can be initiated as soon as possible. Now, the piece of research I was talking about, it's a retrospective study. It's a very interesting paper published recently, 2020, with the effect of combined spinal epidural versus epidural analgesia on fetal heart rate in laboring patients at risk for uteroplacental insufficiency. And the method is actually, as I said, it's a retrospective data analysis from 2012 to 2015 of singleton pregnancies diagnosed with chronic hypertension, gestational hypertension, and or preeclampsia, and or fetal growth restriction, FGR, and receiving neuraxial analgesia intrapartum. The primary outcome of the study was the change in fetal heart rate category following neuraxial analgesia. Now, I know that you know very well the manual review of fetal heart rate tracing was performed, and this manual review, the National Institute of Child Health and Human Development categories are three. And data collection included maternal demographics, blood pressure, uterine tachysystole, uterine hypertonus, mode of delivery, intervention of fetal heart rate abnormalities, and neonatal outcome. Now, you have the results of the study of laboring patients at risk for uteroplacental insufficiency. Patients received anesthesia, epidural anesthesia, in the number was 110. And for the patients receiving combined spinal epidural analgesia, the number was 127. The rate and change in fetal heart rate categories and abnormalities following neuraxial analgesia were the same in both groups. So these are the results. And both epidural and the combined groups resulted in a significant increase in fetal heart rate category 2 from 27.3 to 65.5% for epidural analgesia, and 20.9 to 64.3% for combined analgesia. What is important here is that the fetal heart rate category increased following both combined and epidural analgesia. And the effect of maternal adverse events were not different between both two groups. Now, in conclusion, severe preeclampsia is a complex disease. The treatment should focus on stabilizing blood pressure, optimizing the fluid status, and preventing convulsions. Neuraxial blocks for labor and delivery benefit both the mother and the infant. And for C-section, neuraxial anesthesia is proved to show superiority over general anesthesia. And if general anesthesia is required, pre-anesthesia preparation and airway management are essential. And the safe peripartum management of pre-eclamptic patients and her infant are a team effort involving the anesthesiologist, obstetrician, and neonatologist. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you, Nicole, for this interesting lecture. But I know that you are busy, and thank you for time.
During my work right now, so I would ask if it's possible. I know that you might have questions, or also you might have some projects for future research that you want to elaborate, especially hypotheses, objectives, that you are looking for. So please send me an email. Dr. Madi might be the interface, you know, in this correspondence, and we can discuss modalities of elaborating some projects, kind of like prospective and retrospective research in the same time. This is a very interesting topic.
Yes, thank you, Nicole, for that. So any questions, Paul, you can discuss this and you can send the email. And I think the professor can give us email for
Nicole.